Talk to most grain growers about crop rotation and they'll acknowledge that it makes sense. It's a good way to help keep disease and weed levels down and build up soil nitrogen. However, the use of broadleaf crops in rotations has been in decline in recent years, many growers choosing to grow cereal on cereal instead. It's this dramatic change in crop sequencing that's resulted in a GRDC-funded national research program to examine the consequences of this trend and provide outcomes for grain growers to use in implementing their cropping strategies.
As an agricultural practice, crop sequencing has been around since ancient Roman times. Sandals were the RMs of the day, and a food, feed, and fallow rotation was the go. Crop selection might have been limited, but a Roman estate's cropping land would be split between wheat for human consumption, oats for livestock feed, and a third of the land left fallow. And what became apparent even then was that wheat performed better after a legume. The technology might have changed, but the farming system pretty much remains, as does the Roman forum style of idea exchange. This is a meeting of the National Crop Sequencing Project leaders. It's a GRDC-supported program intended to answer questions raised by the present-day pressure of foregoing crop rotation or sequencing for continuous cereal production.
One reason we're looking at it now is the millennium drought led to a lot of the traditional broadleaf break crops dropping out of the system. And in some respects that made sense in that there were a series of late breaks and the broadleaf crops tend not to cope with drought quite as well as the cereals like wheat. But that's led to wheat being grown after wheat for a number of years.
As a CSIRO survey in 2008-09 reinforced, the survey of Western Australian farm consultants asked them to make use of some of the 10,000 crop records to compare cropping rotations 10 years apart.
What we found was at the turn, sort of at the end of the last millennium, 98, 99, only 5% of wheat crops were grown after a wheat crop. By the end of the decade, that was more than 30%. That's a dramatic shift. That's a rethinking of the rotation. That's as big a management shift as you're going to get in agriculture.
That cropping shift is happening to varying degrees across the nation. And while it might make short-term economic sense, this group of researchers wants to identify the most effective alternative to cereal they can offer grain growers as an option.
To throw almost 2,000 years worth of ideology out the window and say, I'm going to grow cereal on cereal because I believe it's the most economic thing to do. From a scientific perspective, to say the very least, we raise our eyebrows.
Past crop sequencing work is providing the foundation for much of the new research being undertaken.
Okay, so this is an aerial photo of the crop dynamic crop sequence trial at Katanning, taken in the second year of the trial.
Two very detailed and extensive large-scale trials have already taken place in WA. The Katanning and Wongan Hills dynamic crop sequence trials ran between 2008 and 2011 and examined the influence various crop species have on each other.
We sowed 10 different treatments of different species in 1 year in long strips of 100 metres by 10 metres. And in the following year, we sowed across those strips so that we ended up with 100 different combinations of crop sequences within 2 years. And then we put a following two crops of wheat on those to see what the response would be.
Results from the Katanning site highlighted the impact of break crops on following cereals.
Lupin gave a large yield increase. So the wheat produced from a wheat on lupin crop was much higher than the wheat on wheat, both in 2008 and 2009. And you can see from that trial that there's a variation of responses depending on the treatments that we employed at the site.
While at Wongan Hills, the positive impact fallow had on wheat yields was illustrated.
The reasons that we saw those increases in wheat yield after a fallow were different for the 2 years, but in 2010 it was because it was a dry year at the site and we had more moisture available to the wheat. And in 2011 there was an increase in mineral nitrogen available to the wheat crop, and also weeds had been halved because of the fallow that was before that wheat crop.
WA's Department of Agriculture and Food has combined the results of the dynamic crop sequencing trials with a summary of results from another 170 crop rotation trials dating back to 1974. This data bank is now linked to a crop sequence calculator.
You can select which trial you would like to look at, you can select which treatment and from which year you would like to select. So growers can basically look at any rotation that they want to. It gives them the yield, grain price cost and gross margin calculated from the trial. And here it also enables them to change the yield or their grain price or the costs so that they can have a look and play with that and see if it reflects what's happening on their farm. We've been getting really good feedback about this product.
Being able to customise the data allows grain growers from across the nation, not just WA, to use the crop sequencing calculator. It's located on DAFWA's website at www.agric.wa.gov.au. Why growers would sow wheat on wheat when there are proven benefits from alternating cereal with break crops or fallows is being examined further in Martin Harry's Focus Paddocks project.
Okay, so this is the spread of the paddocks that we started in 2010 that we're monitoring in collaboration with 10 grower groups across that area.
188 paddocks across WA's wheat belt are being monitored for weeds, disease, nutrition and the economics of growing the different crop species.
It's a large survey, so that data set's building, and by the end of this year we should have some really good information about what's really happening on the ground with these crops.
That information will be fed back into other projects within the National Crop Sequencing Program. CSIRO's Roger Laws is one of the people who'll be using the data.
We have to explore the possibility that they are adopting a farming system that potentially could collapse through disease or weed pressures. And that's what this project is about. It's about unlocking that risk and getting an insight into what the risks are that farmers may unwittingly have embarked upon with their current rotation choices.
In Perth, Roger Laws has constructed an economic framework to better understand the drivers of crop sequencing. Complex models of weeds, crop diseases and fertiliser requirements have been combined and scenarios projected. His objective is to determine what would be an ideal system. When could a grower consider sowing wheat on wheat? And when would a cropping sequence with break crops be the better option?
Now that economic model told us that price of the crop was extremely important, but also the level of biotic stress. So what do I mean by that? You know, how much disease is in the system? How many weeds are in the system? These sorts of factors. So these sort of biological problems can drastically shift the sort of ideal rotation.
Existing and historic data about weed and disease populations was used in the economic and biophysical models to give the research as wide an application as possible.
We want to know, well, how significant are the disease levels? How much disease inoculum for different diseases like takeall, for rhizoctonia, for crown rot, for root rot, are there? Are they going to proliferate and then damage the crop? Are they going to proliferate and not damage the crop? All these sorts of questions. So we're now using the economic models that we built to tease out the sort of important factors that we think drive whether one rotation or sequence will be successful in one district and whether that same rotation and sequence will be suitable in another district.
To evaluate these outcomes, the Perth team has taken soil infested with rhizoctonia and set up a glasshouse experiment, where wheat sown into the infested soil is exposed to different climates, rainfall regimes, nitrogen and different stubble levels to replicate real conditions and then monitor the seedlings to gauge the level of impact.
It's clear that these biotic stresses, which in this case is rhizoctonia, are having an impact, and that impact changes under climate. So trying to get a handle on that, and then what we want to do is take that and then say, right, this is a climatic scenario that's high risk, so if you were to go wheat on wheat under this situation, there's a good chance you could end up with trouble. Whereas conversely, we should be able to use that information to say, look, this is a system which comparatively appears to be low risk. Therefore, you could perhaps embark on a wheat on wheat system with a lot less uncertainty.
The National Crop Sequencing Program is not anti-wheat on wheat, rather wanting to qualify the impact of it. Results from the glasshouse trial will be fed into the modelling and then shared with growers to use in their own trials. Another factor in the weed and disease risk is the limited number of herbicides that can be used in many parts of the grain belt.
There's a large number of the common grass weeds and broadleaf weeds for that matter are now becoming tolerant or resistant to a range of herbicides, and by using either a canola or a legume crop, it's possible to use a different suite of herbicides to control them.
Mark People's crop sequencing project has enlisted the cooperation of 7 farming groups in the southern grain zone. One Victorian group, the Birchip Cropping Group, ran a 3-year rotation trial focused on gross margins. Legumes, canola and mustard crops were grown in rotation with wheat and contributed to higher gross margins over the 3 years compared to wheat on wheat.
There were 2 treatments, pulses grown for grain or for hay, and both the hay and the grain were valuable. So that set up a good year in year one, but then there were rotational effects on the wheat that was grown after that. And they were still seeing rotational effects in greater wheat yields after either field peas or vetch, 2 years after they'd been grown. So in total terms, it represented somewhere between $150 and $200 per hectare on average per year, greater profit from including a break crop versus the continuous wheat.
In New South Wales, another trial comparing high and low input cost canola, 5 different legume treatments, barley and high and low input wheat provided unexpected results.
And what surprised me was the actual gross margins on the canola. Both canolas were way ahead of the cereals. Only chickpea had a lower gross margin than barley, but it still beat the 2 wheat crops. So that to me was a surprise. And the return, I guess, we're calling it a risk return ratio, where we look at the gross margin and then divide that by the total variable costs to grow it. Essentially all the break crop options, apart from the chickpea, had a return of 2 to 1. So you generated twice as much profit as it cost you in inputs. Now that tends to be contrary to what a lot of farmers believe.
Adelaide-based researcher Nigel Wilhelm is working with farming system groups throughout low rainfall regions, where historically the use of rotation crops has not been a common practice.
I mean, everybody can grow a break crop in a good year, but you know, we don't get a lot of good years in those low rainfall areas, and past experience has shown that they fail far too often to be economically viable. However, we think things have changed substantially since those sort of perceptions have been built. There's been a lot of breeding work on some of our major break crops. They do perform a lot better. Farming systems have changed somewhat so that we're sowing earlier, doing other things which give the break crops a much better chance of performing. I think with current herbicide options, pest control, new genetics, we really think they've got a bigger role in low rainfall farming systems environments than they're currently being used.
So in consultation with the farming groups, break crops they selected as being of interest have been sown in 5 replicated plot trials across the zone.
We're looking at a 4-year series of break crop packages. Starts with 2 years of break crops, followed by 2 years of cereal. So one, it gives us 2 years to investigate a problem and overcome it, which is the reason that people go into a break crop. They're trying to overcome a problem with their long-term cereal paddock. And then we're looking at the cereal production following those break crop packages to see how much impact those break crops are having. And that's the real impact of these break crops. We've got to get enhanced benefit in the following wheat crops to justify their place in the rotation. And with those trials, our benchmark is continuous cereal. So these break crop packages have to outperform continuous cereal, which is the safest and perceived to be the least risky option in these low rainfall environments.
Fallow is also an option in the trials. It's also useful as a scientific control to see what would have happened if there were no crops at all. Results so far are limited to the first year of this 4-year project, but are encouraging.
here's wheat, which is our standard. This is what our break crops have to outperform in term to justify their place in the rotation. And here's one break crop which we're particularly pleased with the performance. This is Twilight Peas, and in this particular circumstance, out-yielded wheat. You can see a range of options here. Canola, the yellow-flowered crop there in the background, a very high-value crop, which is good for these regions which have high transport costs. So a high-value crop, which and some very useful herbicide technology options, which allow them to control what are currently some very problem weeds in these environments. The advantage of our five trial approach is we've got five different environments, five different growing seasons, exposing similar crops to those pressures and opportunities. And I guess across the board, we've been very pleased to see the performance of break crops compared to just another year of wheat. Some of those wheat crops have struggled due to weeds, diseases and fertility, but under those same circumstances, some of the break crops have performed exceptionally well and have actually earned more cash per hectare than the cereal would have been able to achieve.
In the northern grain zone, growers have an advantage, the ability to sow both a winter and summer crop. Using the APSIM model, a biological program that uses long-term weather records, Jeremy Wish has been comparing a northern crop sequencing scenario, including fallows, with cereal-on-cereal farming systems.
Looking at these, you can see the comparison between the role of growing a wheat crop every year, and you can see that you have good years and bad years, but you've also hit these periods in this variable climate where you'll get three or four failed crops in a row. If we look at the absolute flip side of that, which would be growing one crop every 2 years and having a long fallow in between that, you can see that there is a steady climb without as many flats, but you get a much lower accumulative gross margin over a 20-year period. So by trying to manage risk across the whole farm and shifting that fallow period into just one paddock of, say, six or seven, you can start seeing the red line here, which is showing a range of crops, so a number of winter cereal crops plus summer crops plus pulse crops, and seeing how that we, even though in bad years, such as this flat period here, we are still accumulating gross margin every year.
Jeremy Wish and his fellow researchers will meet many times over the next few years. They'll have new results to compare and more information to exchange and outcomes to deliver to growers.
What we'd hope is to be able to provide the farmers with a range or a suite of options about how they can diversify their rotations for a more profitable and sustainable outcome. But I really think there are a place for these break crops to manage these major pressures, weeds, diseases and fertility, in a way that still returns dollars to the business.
While looking after the sustainability of the land as well.
Look, I see it's vital. Crop sequencing and crop rotations, the whole concept underpins agriculture. We've been doing it for thousands of years. Moving into a monoculture environment, while we can understand it, while we can understand the economic drivers, there's nothing but a nagging suspicion in the back of a lot of people's minds that this flies in the face of thousands of years of agriculture. So there's a concern.
What this National Crop Sequencing Initiative has to provide is definitive answers and not quick fixes.
The issues to do with weeds or nitrogen or disease, in some respects you can get something out of a bag or a bottle to deal with those to some degree. But there comes a time when you've got to go beyond that. And having different, even just having different species in the rotation, that diversity leads to a much healthier system. You're putting nitrogen into the system through legumes in an organic form, and that has a lot of benefits for soil structure of things as well as nutrition that you just can't get by putting nitrogen out of a bag. So overall it's more of a holistic approach and a systems approach rather than trying to seek solutions out of a bag.